Sussex is in every way a picture postcard town. Perched on a sandstone rock and surrounded by the sea on one side and by the rivers Breed, Rother and Tillingham on the other three, it's as steeped in history as any town in Britain. The name originates from an old term which was used to describe a bleak island. And Rye itself was once just such an island. Joined to the mainland by a narrow strip of beach. Thus, over the centuries, the marshland emerged from the sea, only to be swallowed up again one fearful flooding night. A verse from The Lost Harbours of Sussex describes it. There rolls the deep where grows the tree. O earth, what changes hast thou seen? There, where the long street roars, hath been the stillness of the central sea. Wesley came to Rye in 1773 and wrote in his diary, "I set out for Sussex and found abundance of people willing to hear the good word, at Rye in particular. And they do many things gladly, but they will not part with the accursed thing, smuggling." The whole atmosphere of the place smells of French brandy, Dutch tobacco, and the tang of moonless nights. Even today, the townspeople are reluctant to be drawn on the amount of illicit trading that still goes on. It's hardly surprising that one of Kipling's most famous poems is based on this charming place. 25 ponies trotting through the dark. Brandy for the parson, baccy for the clerk. Them as ask no questions isn't told a lie. Watch the wall, my darling, while the gentlemen go by. The fishermen of Rye are a race apart. It's a dangerous coast, and when the weather is tolerable, the fishing fleet is out and at work at hours that would cause a strike in any other industry. The men are hard and strong and loyal to each other. Michael Payne, who by himself pilots and fishes from a 40-foot boat, is no exception.
I got up at 2, the wife levered me out of bed. Come down on the boat, came to sea, got out the end of the harbour and someone had lowered a curtain. It was as thick as a hedge. Like that until 9 o'clock, I suppose, just running on radar. In the summer, we're in fairly shallow water, almost up to the beach at times for Dover soles. But in the winter, we're in anything from 10 to 25 fathoms. So some people seem to go off fishing and whatever comes up in the cod end, they're happy with. There's one person in particular likes to catch whiting. Now, they drop down to about pound 80 pence of stone in when they're in full swing, whereas I'd prefer to go and get the same number of individual soles and still make the same money. Although I'd only land maybe a box of fish and he's landing 20 boxes, at the end of the day, on the bottom of the ticket, it would be the same money. For 10 years, there hasn't been a vast increase in the price of place, but it's diesel and gear and insurance, everything shoots up every year.
Some of them look quite vicious. Any of them ever bite back?
Oh, fish?
Yeah.
I thought you meant fishermen. Oh. There's an angler fish. If he's in amongst it and you're kicking it about and you put your feet in his mouth, it makes you hop if he's light enough to lift. Otherwise, you're trapped like a man trap. The trouble is, in a blow, you get a lot of groundswell and you've got to wait more than your normal time and able to get in without hitting the bar at the end, which is quite... it feels like concrete if you hit it, although it's only sand.
With the tradition of fishing and smuggling behind it, it's no surprise that Rye is known in many countries for the quality of its boat building. The ancient crafts have been handed down through the generations. Harry Phillips and his family still run a thriving boatyard on the edge of the marshland.
I was born here, right on the spot nearly where we are now. Yeah. Yeah.
And how much has the town itself changed in that time?
Oh, tremendous lot. Where you're standing now, where we're sitting, the trawler used to come along here and tie up. And the barges, everything used to come up there.
Bringing what sort of things?
Oh, cheese, gravel, coal, timber, all manners of things. Well, we call it a beach boat, specially designed for the beach. So they got a very fine, very blunt forefoot. You know, as you come round the stem, well, in the old days, that was very blunt, so when they came ashore with the surf behind them, they shoot up the beach. Because they only had a lug, so they never had engines in them in them days, you know, you had to row the darn things.
Have things changed since engines came?
Oh, yes, the forefoot has to be much finer. I said a pound so much as smash them all up, the forefoot, you see. And the timbers and kills used to be all oak. All oak were grown not far away. Witch elm for the boats. Witch elm is like gold. It really is. And I mean, there you are, it's been butchered and cut down and never been replaced. That's the trouble. It takes a long time to grow, witch elm does. Some of it's been coming from right away down Devon, Cornwall and down that way. Oh, witch elm's lovely, lovely wood to work. Yeah. You mustn't let it get too dry, though, or else it gets brittle. That's the trouble with the boat, see? A lot of people think you want witch elm, especially, must be about 50-50. Or else, when you rivet it together and it gets wet, if it's too dry, it stretches the copper nails, and when it settles down, of course, you've got a boat that's like a sieve all the time. A lot of people have made that mistake, you know, when they've asked us, give them what's going to build them. When we tell them it wants to be 50-50, they don't believe us. Not till they built it and found out afterwards. Don't have no drawings, no nothing. Everything's there. They just tell you what you want, and you know what they want. It's been in the family for years, that design.
Every winter Wednesday, the Marsh farmers come to Rye to sell their sheep at the market at the bottom of the town. The meat gets its special flavour from the salt on the sea grasses. Farmer Bill Cook is a regular at the sales.
This market, you know, has been going up since 1859.
35, 10 now, sir, 35, 10, 5, 10, 5, 20, 5, 20, 30 now.
I can remember small farmers would bring in butter, eggs, and, you know, everything was very different in, you know, in my earlier days.
580,
well, it's all sheep now. There was a time when there was cattle, sheep and pigs, but it's just sheep alone now.
And Luton Girls Choir said 2, 10, 20, 30, 230, 40, 240.
And where do you draw your sheep from? The whole of Romney Marsh and the background?
Yes, Romney Marsh and quite a lot up into the Weald areas like Northiam and as far as Battle probably. Well, we've got South Downs, Dorsets, Suffolk Crosses, North Country Greyfaces, Texel Crosses, which are Dutch. There's a tremendous variety. I mean, when I first started here, there have only been South Downs and Kents, and it's a very big change. But there's still more Romney ewes, or Kents as we call them, than any other breed around here still.
Christmas, Rye regains much of its ancient glory. The years roll back and the Rye singers, who have an international reputation, start their rehearsals at St. Mary's Church, all of 800 years old, for their annual carol concert. Soprano and former mayor Joe Kirkham is one of the enthusiasts.
Rye is a lovely place to live. It's very small, but the advantage with that is everyone knows everyone else. And you walk along the street and you keep meeting friends. And it can take you half an hour to get along from one end of the high street to the other. Very beautiful, and a day like you've had today, beautiful sunshine, very attractive, and you make you feel really grand to live here. Choir tapped an old Methodist junior choir which people had enjoyed singing when they were children, and when Leslie, our conductor, came to live here and wanted to start a choir, these people found that they liked to sing and started to sing again, and then people like myself joined in who'd sung in other places in the country as well, and so we all live here now, but we're a marvellous cross-section of the people of Rye. We have sung on several occasions this lovely old Sussex carol. People are very fond of it because it is such a traditional one in this area.
Thank you.
local clay has been used by potters over the centuries. It tempted Wally Cole down from London after he was demobbed at the end of the war, and today he's just part of a thriving local industry.
We were digging it on the marsh, just close to the sea. And then, about 20-odd years ago now, the sea tried to come back over the marsh and they built this enormous seawall. And then after that, we were all stopped digging this side of it in case we weakened the wall. So then we had to go out and we brought in a white clay from Cornwall, a red clay from Devon, and we mixed them so that they bore the same colour as our local. We came here in 1947 after the war, after demob. We're foreigners, really and truly. You have to be born in Rye to be a Rye. But it was nice to be out of London, really. Yeah, I threw my first pot in 1930. And I've always worked on a kick wheel. I personally think there is a closer harmony between your mind and your foot on a kick wheel than on the machine one. But that's personal preference, really. It's like painting on blotting paper. As soon as you touch a wet brush to the dry powder, it sucks into it, so you can't alter it. So the decorators have to get very dexterous in doing just what is wanted and leaving it.
At the top of the town, Alan Webb is up before first light, along with the Rye fishermen. But his task is to bake bread and make cakes. His bakery is a magnet for the townspeople and, of course, for the summer tourists.
It's a skilled job, obviously. I get up at 4:30. Every morning, apart from the weekends when I get up at 2:30 Saturday morning, so it's a bit earlier. But Saturday is a different sort of day. We tend to make only the bread and morning stuff on a Saturday. Confectionery lines are usually done beforehand and baked off on a Saturday morning, but they're pre-prepared. We don't stay longer than about 10 or 11 o'clock Saturday morning. We do it all by hand, apart from the mixing. All the moulding and scaling is done by hand here. The oven is, we suspect, the original. The firm whose name appears over the top, Smith and Son, another old established firm of oven builders, they've recently gone out of business, but they did in fact do the present conversion to the gas firing. And Mr. Smith considered that the brickwork of the oven was older than the front. That the front at some time has been renewed, the brickwork is probably original, probably around 200 years old, which ties up with the little sign on the front of the shop that says 260 years old. But I have seen documentary evidence of this building being a bakery in 1779.
Thank you. One of the impressive features of Rye is how spick and span everything seems. Even at the height of the holiday season, the streets are clean and free from rubbish. The credit for this goes to the local dustmen. One of them is Brian Chapman, known to his friends as Ringo.
Rye is a lovely old ancient town, and it's a privilege to sort of live in it.
You see it from a different angle to most people. Do you see it earlier in the morning or what?
Oh yes, fairly early, about 7 o'clock in the morning, when most people are tucked up in bed. And well, there's not many people going about that time of the morning, and it gives us a chance to get through the town. My mum and I was born in Canberra, and our relations are all sort of scattered around Canberra and Rye. My great-granddad, he was a kettle net fisher, quite famous for it, and some of the other ancestors brought grass from Holland over to Canberra and planted it there. I like to sort of help Rye if I can by sort of giving them a service.
It's likely that strange faces have been treated with some suspicion and mistrust in Rye ever since AD 450, when the area was shut in by the Saxons and the Jutes on the east and west, by the sea in the south, and by the forest of Anderida in the north. In this part of Sussex today, people are still reticent, especially with foreigners. With good reason, for one Rye citizen told us that if hell was like his town in the summer with the visitors, then he would change his ways immediately. In December, it's nevertheless a beautiful, peaceful, and eccentric place. Just the town for a local lad to take his llama for its daily walk.